I really would, if KLG gamble on the mid game this time around again, expect them to go a little bit harder on it.
Well, we'll see if they do, but we are into Champion Select, of course, ladies and gentlemen. LeBlanc gonna hit the bench first, and wow. I wonder whether this is a bit of a trickle over from our previous game. Lissandra gonna be taken off the board, aimed at possibly Energy there. We'll see entirely who that is. Of course, Energy is known to play that one in the mid lane, but Lissandra has sort of fallen out of the meta here just a little bit.
Yeah, it certainly has fallen out of the meta. Still a good anti-dive champion, so I would expect that one to go over to Energy. He is the known Lissandra player coming across from Beşiktaş, and we'll see exactly where it goes. Actually, they don't ban for their second ban. We'll have to check whether they lost a ban there. Lulu also taken off the rift here for KLG.
Oh, actually, it's just the other way around.
It's
there,
just the other way around. It's being switched.
I'm very perplexed. No, it's not. So Sejuani going to hit the bench as well. Morgana taken away. So a lot of these control champions removed here by KLG. They don't want to see anything like that protect the AD carry type composition to come through. And I think that suits Zykro here and KLG's just general playstyle around a mid-game carry as opposed to the late-game hyper carry.
Yeah, exactly right. But we do see once again, somehow, Hecarim has once again got through pick ban. I want to say he's 100% so far. I'm pretty sure he is.
It certainly feels that way. And we've seen Hecarim's just be so devastating. Whether they take the Ignite teleport for that earlier Trinity Force power spike or whether they go for that Cinderhulk smite teleport style. I believe I said smite teleport twice in a row. One of those is Ignite teleport, of course, with that early Trinity Force. But we shall see what KLG take away. And it's the Zed to be locked in here. And of course, Reggie loves picking that one up in the mid lane, and he just loves his assassins in general.
Yeah, so once again, a little bit more mid game, a split pusher coming out for Reggie. That's good because it can maybe draw the Hecarim away from the fight and force some 1v1s around the map. Also, Bear going for a little bit more of an engaged support. It's not the Annie that
and
we wanted,
the pick but away
it's
from a thresh,
but it
as well.
Is the pick away. And that's what I was going to mention. We said that Bear doesn't really play it to our knowledge. Possibly could. I mean, there's lots of games that go on.
I think if you're a support player, you have to play.
Yeah, it's kind of like, I'm a jungler, I play Lee Sin.
Yeah.
I'm an AD carry, I play Lucian. Although that one doesn't count.
Not so much. It's more like Sivir at the moment. What would be the stock standard AD carry?
If you can't play Lucian, you cannot AD.
All right, got it. There we are. I learned something today. I can't play AD carry. Energy still thinking about his pick. Only 5 seconds to go. It is going to be Sivir, though, here for Nardius.
And I like that already, their comp is so much better coming through from the Turkish team. They've got that tanky lineup. They've got the Gragas. They've got the Hecarim. Then they've got the go button that we'll talk to you about.
Yeah, exactly.
They're starting to put it together. On the other side of the rift, Graves being hovered. Good lane bully coming through for Zykro. That's what, when against Lion Gaming, that's when he looked most impressive. If I think he played a game one against them. So.
Yep.
See whether he can translate that into a good performance in the early game. But Zach would be an interesting pickup here.
Yeah, and you actually mentioned to us before that sort of he's the third round of these tanky junglers that have really come through. Of course, Sejuani and Gragas being a little bit further ahead, but he still has mammoth gank potential and, of course, can gank from a long way away as well.
Yeah, certainly can, but he's not going to be picked, so I'll bench my spiel that I was going to go for there. It is actually going to go Rek'Sai here in the jungle. No, it's not. It's going to be Rumble in the top lane. They've gone super mid game.
Yeah, and Helio, also massively known for that Rumble, was seeing a whole lot of bans even recently as well. Nardius hovering an Urgot. Well, let's not talk about these hovers because Brand's there.
Urgot is great against the Zed in the mid lane. Really good laner against Zed. So I would not be surprised if that was a legitimate pick.
Well, we'll see whether it comes through. A whole lot of cycling being done here for Beşiktaş so far. Our Turkish members having a definite think or just a spam of that random button. Not entirely sure. Nardius, see what they consider because, of course, they're looking for a mid laner and a support. Janna definitely makes sense here. Dumbledoge able to pick that one up. Of course, known for it. But of course, a little bit more known for that Thresh.
They're really worried about this Zed, it looks like, as they finally settle on the Ahri as their pick. So that will be a Zed versus Ahri matchup. This is one of those matchups that I give it firmly to Zed now. I've had enough of the skill matchups.
I just see Ahri and I think skill matchup.
Yeah, everyone says that, but I think that Zed currently wins the lane. The removal of DFG closed down a lot of your skill matchups.
Oh, come on. I learned this from Papa Smithy, okay? You see an Ahri and you just get to say skill matchup. I'm getting nothing from you, Spawn. I'm getting nothing. Oh, man. KLG, they do have their final pick here to round out the lineup. It is going to be the jungle, which is an interesting one to save until last pick, but when you've got so many of these priority solo lanes to come through, of course, Zed here for Reggie, one of his favorite champions to take into that mid lane, and Helios sort of known for his rumble. See what they do take into the jungle, and man, it might be a Nunu. And is that going to work out for late game insurance or just for early game counter jungling?
Yeah, Nunu's a kind of weird pick in this one because he's used, like, we talk about Nunu in so many different ways. He's used to control the enemy jungler. He's used to get a hyper carry going. But the other thing that we don't really talk about is his zone control and his objective control.
Okay.
So the thing about Nunu in this composition is they're hoping to get early dragons because they're a mid-game comp. So you think, no-brainer. Yep. But what this does, and I was just talking to Papa Smithy, the skill matchup king, about this before, that if a team is 5,000 gold ahead and they have three dragons before 30 minutes, they nearly always win the game at the moment because fifth dragon is just such a powerful tool. And if you're that far behind at the 30-minute mark, you really can't leave your base to fight these guys. So all of a sudden, the game has this timer on it and it gets so condensed and you're fighting over an objective. So what Nunu does, he secures the early dragons. He makes Graves a little bit more scaling into late game because Graves, of course, scales very well with crit and attack speed.
Yep.
Gives Zed some attack speed as well. But more importantly, during these mid-game fights, the Equalizer as well as the Absolute Zero are going to be really hard to run through because there's not very many gap closers from Gragas, from Hecarim. So when they use their ultimate, when they use their Body Slam, that's all they've got in their kit. This isn't like Aurelia where they're going to have a quick dash coming through all the time. They're going to have to walk through a lot of that zone. And hopefully that is enough to protect what KLG are bringing to the table.
Yeah, not to mention, you know, Equalizer, like you said, but the box over the top of it as well. The box as well can be left down, and it's not like you can explosive cask someone out of it on your team. So you're going to have the box down for a massive 90% slow, plus the Equalizer locking people in it with the box. Like, that is very, very scary. You pair that with the Absolute Zero as well. Like you mentioned, zone control for days.
Yeah, exactly right, ladies and gentlemen. We actually have a pause at the start of the game. That's why we're taking a little bit longer to jump into this one. But I actually like what KLG have done here. They've completely disregarded the meta, and I love when teams do this. They've picked it up, thrown it out the window, and said, that is not how we play League of Legends. Instead, we are going to commit to mid-game. Because that's how we play League of Legends. We love Rumble. We love Zed.
Yeah.
This is what our brand is. And we're just going to beat you. No matter what you guys think is good, this is what we know and have proven because they got here.
Yeah, by
ruining their region. So they're bringing a tried and true lineup in. And I really think that this is their best way to win a game.
And I think also the best way to win a game of League of Legends is to dictate the pace of the game as well. So if you're the one in control, if you're the one calling the shots, and you're telling the other team to play your brand of League of Legends, that is how you win. Because otherwise, you're uncomfortable, but you're being dictated to, you're playing reactionary, and that is not how you win.
Yeah, exactly right. And look, going across Beşiktaş's lineup, they've got a good scaling comp, but this isn't a ridiculous scaling comp. This isn't something like you've got, I don't know, like Cho'Gath, Sejuani, I don't know, Super Tank in top lane, Kog'Maw, Lulu running around on the Rift. Like, game hits 45 minutes, you kill everything with a Kog'Maw kind of composition.
Oh, you mean like Nasus, Sion,
yeah,
Viga?
Yeah, there you go. Thank you.
80-minute game.
Yeah. So they don't have the scaling composition of all scaling compositions. Maybe not to the extreme of that, but they have a decently late game composition, but they're not going to shrug off five dragons and a 5,000 gold deficit with what they're bringing to the table.
Yeah, and I mean, like, Ahri is considered arguably a mid-game champion as well, and Sivir with the short range, not going to be able to siege very well, of course, still does fantastic damage in the late game, but is still a bit dangerous to use. You're exactly right that our Turkish lineup, I mean, despite Hecarim and Gragas also being, largely a scaling champion, it's about all they're throwing at it.
Yeah, I think that Sivir and Hecarim are the kind of two late game carries there. I don't think Gragas is any good late game. He becomes like Lee Sin. He's used for his ultimate. Mid game does very meaningful damage.
I thought
that's
what made him good, Lee Sin, is the fact that he's still relevant in the late game.
He's more relevant than Lee Sin because he has his E and his Q.
Yeah.
But he's still not a damage threat in the late game. So he's still just used for his displacement more than anything in his CC. I'm kind of two ways about Ahri, depending on how you build her. I think that Ahri does ridiculous amounts of damage with Luden's Echo. I think a lot of champions do, and that if she ever gets past the front line and it gets anywhere near Graves, he just incidentally dies, unfortunately, due to Foxfire and Luden's Echo being so strong at the moment. So I think that they still have some keys, but as I said, the more frightening thing is, how do you fight a Nunu Rumble Graves for the first three dragons? I just don't know whether it's possible with their lineup, unless they get a really good pick.
So is it KLG all fighting around objectives more than anything else this game and making sure that their neutral control is really on the board?
Yeah, so what I think Beşiktaş actually have to do is lane swap, push down the early turret, and get an artificial gold lead.
Okay.
So give up the first two dragons and then take two turrets for it. All of a sudden, you're 3,000 gold advantage just because of the global gold you've picked up.
Yeah.
They haven't got 3,000 gold worth of stats off their first dragon or second dragon yet because they haven't got into scaling mode. And then you just beat them around like the level 12, level 13 mark when the third dragon's coming up. So I think that that is what the game plan that they'll go for. As I said, I think they're a very good lane swapping squad. That's why I place them so high in the power ranking. I think that other teams are going to struggle playing around that. So I think that's how they try and play the game. But as I said, that's a lot of ifs in a sentence for me to be confident on what they're bringing.
Yeah, and I'm excited to see, of course, Reggie there on his comfort pick and Helior as well. I mean, I've personally experienced a lot of hype about this guy's Rumble play, and I really want to see how he dominates the lane, whether he even dominates the lane, and what we can expect out of this guy. Because, of course, Rumble versus Hecarim, Hecarim not so strong there in the early phase, and if they get standard lanes here, KLG, then Helio might be able to run away with it.
Yeah, exactly right. And my favorite thing about Hecarim is everyone says he does so much with so little, and that's true. But he also does even more when he has a lot. So if you're able to pick up items on Rumble, it's not like he stays the same. Like, it's double pen versus double pen death cap. Like, the second one definitely wins out. So, like, it's not just that he's a good lane swap champion. He's able to go into the 1v1s if he can dictate the pace of the lane. And he should be able to against a Hecarim who does take some time to scale up. Really is open for Helior in the top lane to be able to carry if he gets some ganks.
Yeah, we'll see whether he can because, of course, yeah, Rumble can actually single-handedly destroy a game because if you're able to get into that backline, become that golden flamethrower with the early Zhonya's Hourglass, things can go horribly wrong.
Yeah, it certainly can and get you another spell rotation out. Zhonya's just such a good item on Hecarim, as you mentioned.
Maybe on Rumble?
Rumble.
I don't know. I'd build it on Hecarim, but I'm an idiot, so...
Well, hey, you said it.
I believe you've probably said it too, my friend.
Not on stream. I'm not that mean.
Oh, wow. Okay, just to my face?
Yep.
Yeah, okay, cool. Thank you very much for that one. We've successfully completely derailed our top lane conversation. So let's move to the mid lane, of course. We have mentioned already the Ahri versus Zed matchup, but is it going to change up the Ahri build path here, having to go against a Zed? Are we going to expect an early arm guard here really delaying that Luden's Echo, or do you still run for it?
No, so this is why I think that Zed wins out in the lane now, because you have to commit to it. And the other thing is that Zed has kind of figured out the Ahri matchup. What you do is you kind of wait behind your creeps, and then she has to burn one charge of her ultimate and throw out the charm. And at that time, you ult. So charm misses. So Zed dodges charm with his ultimate. From there, he's just able to go back to his shadow and nullify it. And you think, okay, that's not winning a lane matchup. That's just not dying. But what that does is then you have a split pushing threat with Zed. So where Ahri is looking for picks and you need to build a composition around picking, if you're with an Ahri, you have to have very good denial of vision, be able to set up around objectives and even have a lead to force people into the funnel.
Mm-hmm.
Zed doesn't play any of those games. Zed split pushes throughout the mid game. So what that means is whilst you have a whole team focusing on utilizing an Ahri, Zed just goes around and does his own thing. The rest of the team survives as a unit of four, which is much easier to do than deny complete vision from an objective, especially if you ever fall behind. And he has much clearer keys to success. So the reason I think that Zed at the moment wins out on the matchup isn't for the fact that he completely overthrows the lane. It's because what happens when you translate into a mid-game lead? And I think that it's just a lot harder, especially with the tanky compositions to come through, to execute with pick champions than it is to execute with an assassin split pusher that can also team fight relatively well.
Yeah, that's a good point. And actually augmenting that as well is you're talking about sort of mid-game control and early-game power here at the same time. I mean, Julius Tito versus Theocles here, Rek'Sai versus Gragas. Gragas with a bit of early-game power there with the body slam, of course, having a little bit of CC on it. But Rek'Sai is, she's like probably one of the best early gankers in the game. That Umburo is just fantastic.
Yeah, it certainly is, but unfortunately not in the game. It's a Nunu.
Oh, it was a Nunu. My bad.
Yep, so that was a late swap out. I forgive you for that one. So yeah, if we follow with that, Gragas actually has probably one of the best early game ganks.
Well, in comparison to Nunu now? No,
early game ganks. I'm talking even Rek'Sai. He has kind of the same thing. He has the good old body slam flash in any direction you want to have the guaranteed knock up as well. Mm. So I think that, and he also sticks relatively well with red buff, but I think that Nunu does something that he doesn't do, and that's pressure jungle very well. So he'll be able to get into Gragas's jungle, be able to push him around a little bit. Gragas, if he misses the body slam, goes on such a long cooldown that he has trouble chasing people out of his jungle. So Nunu has the potential to be able to run around, cause some havoc, counter gank some lanes, and get people going.
Yeah, and just throw ice blasts randomly about the lanes as well. I mean, it's always fun to see the Nunu drive by a gank there around the mid lane or something like that, but it actually does help. I mean, you can sort of gain an advantage by zoning a mid lane champion or a top lane or even a couple of people in the bottom lane.
Yeah, definitely. Relieving of pressure and, I guess, the drive by or even running behind people and auto attacking them out of lane with Nunu, you get ridiculously tanky early game. You just go like your jungle item into Sightstone and you eat a large camp, and all of a sudden you have like 7,000 health and you just run into lane and wail on people. Very hard to get away from him. So yeah, I definitely think that Nunu brings a different kind of pressure to a game. He brings kind of the hybrid, I'm not going to kill you, but I'm really annoying and pesky to deal with.
Yeah, and we'll see whether he manages to pull that off, because of course when you've got an early game focused comp here like KLG have, you sort of really do have to double down on that early pressure. And I'm just worried about Nunu being enough pressure for that.
Yeah, and you know, that's definitely a valid point. We'll see exactly how KLG play around it. As I said, their bottom lane kind of doesn't need jungle help, so it will be up to their mid and top lane to really call Julius Tito around the map and try and get him to influence the lanes where they need to. Hecarim, without any gap-closing summoner spells, is a very easy gank coming through for Nunu, because as I said, he just walks in and snowballs, but we'll have to see exactly how it works out.
Well, we are going to be able to now, ladies and gentlemen, as we hop onto the rip for Beşiktaş versus KLG. Brazil taking on Latin America, and we'll see exactly how this one turns out.
Turkey taking on Latin America.
Turkey. I'm just completely out of my mind. It's absolutely fine. Reggie, here in the mid lane, is going to be able to put a ward down.
Hook comes through, actually lands early.
Yeah, Nadia's getting hooked up there. Didn't take the spell shield level one, unfortunately, but going to be safe.
Actually has hope in lane now because he didn't skill that. Wasn't in much.
That would have been pretty smooth reflexes if you can skill it and use it in that time.
Yeah, but as we saw, game one, taking an incorrect spell for a lane is not a great tactic to just survive a little bit of poke coming through, but in the end, not much happening here. We're going to see whether they can secure standard lanes. And it actually looks like on Beşiktaş' side, they're happy to do it.
Yeah, no deep vision to come through here. And Janisiva versus Graves Thresh seems to me like it goes horribly.
Wow, and Dumbledoge getting chunked out. That was through his shield as well. So all of a sudden, they know exactly where the Graves Thresh lane is. Zyko as well as Bear doing a lot of damage. And Julius Tito, he's going to be rocking the Nunu bot skin.
Yeah, and Dumbledoge actually deciding that they are more than happy to stick to these standard lanes as well.
Yeah, so maybe it's about getting the Hecarim ahead. As we see Energy pushing out early, always a good tactic against melee mid laners to try and shove as hard as you can. The problem is, Zed, he pushes back real well.
Yeah, and Orb of Deception is going to land. Shuriken's not quite on point here for Reggie so far. Helior not going to find anyone in his lane because, of course, Thaldren happy to jungle around first up. You don't need Smite on Hecarim to be able to take an early camp. Is he going to be able to just use that flask, then head back to base, grab some more consumables, and head into lane?
Yeah, and surprisingly, Helior didn't do the AD carry trick where you stack the wave. Actually kills an extra minion or two generally when you do that, and pushes it in your favor, especially if he's going to call Julius Tito up there for an early gank. Would have been something he could have looked at. Instead, just chooses to last hit, and nothing exciting is going to happen because consumables picked up, standard lanes, although in the bottom, Baron Zykro zoning with an early level two. That's cute.
Yeah, not too bad at all. Of course, quick draw and buckshot being pretty helpful, and Flay Death Sentence also pretty good. So the level two hit by this KLG lineup, definitely strong. Eye of the Storm, not really going to protect Nardius too much, but one auto attack, he is going to be able to survive that one.
Yeah, he certainly is. They finally get a creep to get the next level. Bear just showed a really good example of why sometimes it's better to hold a spell than use it, by the way, because as soon as he missed that Death Sentence, all, I guess, cause for concern was gone out of that lane. They were never going to be able to kill them at that point, so they really could have just walked back up to it. As Julius Tito doesn't go for a full clear, instead just, oh, Reggie misses everything. Takes his red buff next. He's going to go to the top, pick up some Krugs, and then go back to shop probably because there's an early ward coming out.
Yeah, and we'll see whether he does put extra pressure here on the top side of the map. Theocles is going to be able to take down this Rift Scuttler.
That's a really cool name, by the way. Theocles, I like that.
Yeah. Oh my goodness, Dumbledoge actually taking a point-blank buckshot. That is not a great idea as he takes a whole bunch of health, but...
And you need to be careful here, Theocles, because there is a minion wave coming, and if you gank this, you're in a lot of trouble, because I don't know whether that was a cannon wave. I didn't actually get to see, but those little guys do so much damage early game.
Yeah, well, this is the thing. It's actually something that a lot of people do fail to take into account whilst trying to trade.
Okay,
Theocles,
so now this is a better time to gank, because the wave isn't coming down. So he has this gap where you see there between the turrets. He can gank without any hindrance.
Yeah, actually, quick draw is going to get him out of the way here as Micro. Oh my goodness, the first blood comes down already, and man, Bear just exploded.
Yeah, and talking about that flash body slam gank to cancel the animation, yeah. All of a sudden in his face, energy getting ganked here.
Yeah, Julius Tito coming in, but a charm lands. Reggie does land some shurikens there, but not quite enough. And the gank pressure from Anunu, not quite enough early on.
Yeah, but he does chunk him out. He's got no mana. So all of a sudden, Reggie, complete control as he misses a cannon. The cardinal sin of mid laners. He needs a talking to.
He does. He does. Does have a CS advantage, though, despite not quite landing that cannon creep.
Another
one. KLG. Unfortunate. Unfortunate stuff, but... Zykro, oh my goodness, that spell shield was fantastic on the buckshot as the trade comes through beautifully here for the Sivir. Theocles possibly could have looked for something there. He's going to body slam over the wall and find Reggie here. Lots of damage down. Takes a bit back there from the shurikens. But
yeah, Reggie's going to have to back now. Yeah. And all of a sudden, energy, complete control over the wave. Even Hylia not doing really well in the top lane. So overall, really good. And another foot comes through.
Thank you very much, NZ Smite, for another...
And your face is right between his toes, Atlas. I like that one.
Well, look, that is called eating my words, because that was a beautiful tweet.
As a good trade goes down in the bottom lane, all of a sudden, Bear looking to get aggressive. Zykro, he really can't go with that one. Teleport burn in top lane. Helior has to get back in there. All of a sudden, it's a 700 gold lead as we have a pause. And KLG, we said they had early game picks. They're not doing great early game.
Yeah, and across the map, we've got CS advantages forming now for our Turkish team, and Beşiktaş really looking strong here moving forward, and that definitely does show warning signs here. But is there sort of a mid-game spike that KLG are going to hit that sort of means that certain, I guess, small leads aren't really going to matter?
Yeah, they have a much better level 6 coming through overall. Like, their Equalizer, Nuno Ultimate, as well as Collateral Damage are just... beast level 6 abilities, yeah. Not to mention the box from Thresh is just devastating at that point in the game. So they definitely have better level 6, but it's more about like what this does for your mentality, where it puts you on the map. If you lose early turrets, what do you lose with it? Are you giving up control? Are they able to transfer a lot of this early gold now into ward coverage? And can they ward really deep and then just never have to deal with the fact that they've got this huge ultimate combo because they just see them coming and are able to exit the area before they get there? There's a lot of things that you have to take into consideration when you're hitting your power spikes and whether you're doing it at a time that the other team can't deal with it or whether you're hitting a great spike yourself, but you've given the team, I guess, an option to be able to navigate around yours.
Yeah, well, we'll see whether they actually can because... Of course, one thing that we haven't actually brought up is the fact that Dumbledoge is on the Janna here. And Dumbledoge is sort of known for roaming around the map making plays. Can you still do that? And can you do it as effectively on a Janna?
You certainly can do it. Whether you can do it as effectively is definitely open for a debate, I guess.
I mean, we've seen certain players do the same sort of tactic on a Morgana without Dark Binding. So it can actually be effective.
Yeah, exactly right. Anything is possible in the League of Legends, Atlas. That's why we play the game. Otherwise, we'd just give the awards out in Champion Select. But I don't know, you can go for sick insect plays, I guess, with Janna as well. You can flash behind people and blow them away, but will he do it? I have no idea. Like, we'll have to...
Do you call that a monsec?
I like that.
Okay.
Yep.
We'll try and use that. Let's not
trending?
Use that. Yeah.
Monsec?
Oh, God.
You can also... she has two forms of CC in her kit. She has the slow. She has the fact that she can use the knock-up from her Q coming through there. If you charge it and you're really good with it, you can knock people up even further. So I guess she does have the tools to be able to do it. Is she as good as Thresh at doing it? Definitely not. But, you know, not many people are as good as Thresh or Nautilus.
Well, that's the thing. And we'll see whether that one does come through. We are going to have the pause discontinue now as... Helior continuing to try and farm out this wave. Does have the makings of his haunting guys here early on, but is 10 CS behind as a Descent's going to land here on a Dumble Doge on the bottom side. He's going to flash out of the way as the land is there. Zykro taking a whole lot of damage as Nardius able to get a boomerang over across, but Dumble Doge still surviving. And Eye of the Storm, just Janna in general, is so difficult to lock down.
Yeah, she certainly is. She has everything in her kit that we just mentioned to roam in disengage, and that's just way too much to be able to deal with if you don't have a gap closer, if you don't have any burst damage coming through. And unfortunately, because of no mana and no HP, KLG didn't have either coming through from their AD carry player. So now, just going to have to push out the lane as Reggie's caught. No, he hasn't. The Oculus is fine.
Yeah, he's going to take a shuriken to the back of the head, but other than that, he is going to be fine. Thaldren was moving down here as well. So the 2v1 was on Helior. Is able to get a ward down. Spots that Theocles
good
is there.
Ultimate.
Equalizes down. And Theocles takes half of his health.
Yeah, and Thaldren actually walked back through the other side of it as well. So in the end, fantastic ultimate. Thing I liked about it the most,
nice.
Hugged the wall. So the last thing that you could do is really walk into that gank at all if you Gragas, because you had to take the long way around. There was no way you were going to get through it without taking all your health and damage. So it was just complete abandoned ship at that stage.
Yeah. I just want to point out as well that that was the first time I've ever seen a Rift Scuttler move in a way a player wanted it to. When Julius Dito just threw an Ice Blast at it and then it sprinted back towards him so he could last hit it. Lovely stuff.
No Scuttlecraft.
Yeah, I'm going to call Julius Dito the Scuttle Crab Whisperer from now on, because that was stunning. He's going to be able to take down a blue buff here as well. We'll see whether he actually gives it over to Reggie for the energy regen and, of course, the extra experience, because a lot of the reason why you give away a blue buff is also so you can stay in range of the experience of your opponent as well.
Yeah, it certainly is. So a huge experience bonus goes across, not to mention the fact that Zed, I think, arguably needs it more than some mid laners.
Energy, some mana users, really.
Yeah, energy regen is just so important to be able to keep up with the spam that comes through from the likes of Ahri, and she will pick up. Reggie's not having any luck with his shurikens, by the way. Eventually, energy will pick up some form of mana regen, whereas you can't itemize from energy regen. And if you mark up one shuriken like that, one E, you mess up your whole combo and you just don't do the damage if you don't have it there. So it is quite important on Zed to be able to pick that up.
Yeah, and also your all-in, of course, with the death mark is also a little bit augmented as well by that blue buff, because you can get an extra round of spells in.
Yeah, definitely, and he's gated by it. And the other thing that people say, cooldown reduction, not like because of the way he is gated by energy isn't fantastic, but I guess they don't notice the fact that his ultimate comes up a lot earlier if you have more cooldown reduction.
Yeah.
So if you're ever going to ult someone, blue buff is a great tool to have as well. Like, his whole kit benefits from it, really.
And he's going to go for the Bilgewater Cutlass here first as well. And I personally do like the Brutalizer first a little bit better. But of course, if you are going to all in with that death mark, Julius Dito waiting around here does spot the fact that energy's here. The flash immediately from Helior, but second kill to go down as the flash away from energy is going to keep him safe. And Julius Dito unable to offer too much more. Reggie's coming through, but not sure whether we'll be able to get too much done. Ice Blasts are coming down thick and fast. Reggie trying to close the distance, but they are going to get safely under the turret, and Thaldren and Energy just walk away.
Yeah, they just roam out, and Julius Dito really didn't commit to that one, as once again, Theocles, he has the positioning to be able to gank bottom lane. doesn't go for it in the end because Sekiro and Bear, they back away, but this is much better out of the Turkish team. This is what we're expecting coming in as Reggie. Oh, that was way too much red dot syndrome. He cannot have not noticed that there was a pink ward in the bro.
You might just clear out the wave and then grab the pink ward because he wanted to shove it into the turret.
Potentially. Yeah, yeah. It is. Thank goodness. I was scared there for a second, Atlas.
No, I trusted in the power of Reggie. Helio, though, is going to continue pushing out these minion waves. He is down by a whole lot of farm, though. 24 CS is nothing to scoff at here at the 10-minute mark. And when it's a Hecarim who is going to vastly outscale you, already going towards that Trinity Force with the home guard boots already built up, that is frightening stuff.
Yeah, it certainly is. And Hecarim, as you said, really good at scaling up. Not to mention the fact that they've only got a short-range AD carry coming through there. So Graves, he's in a lot of trouble for the entirety of this map if Hecarim is able to get going, as once again, they go in on the bot lane.
Yeah, beautiful spell shield again as the Howling Gale comes across. Zykro forced to use the heal. That collateral damage did next to nothing as the Monsoon comes down as well. Dumbledore, but man, the Buckshot's still doing some work here as Nardius doesn't have the spell shield up. Helior coming in. The Equalizer a little bit questionable as another beautiful Howling Gale comes down. Dumbledore able to disengage, but the damage is done. KLG, they pick up the AD carry and they might be able to get a dragon.
Yeah, they certainly look like they're going for the early one. So finally something goes right for KLG. They're going to be able to pick this one up pretty much uncontested. And maybe this will kickstart the snowball of objectives that they really need to take over in the mid game.
Well, if they still manage to take down four dragons in a row, then definitely that's one of their win conditions still definitely in the bag. But if Beşiktaş can get together and really manage to put it to KLG, it's going to be difficult. And now with a gold lead as well, 1,000 gold in favor of our Turkish team. It's looking frightening for the mid game comp.
Yeah, it certainly is. And that Equalizer, he tried to go for the maximum. Unfortunately, Theocles had already flashed, so it really was never in danger of being able to pick that one up. It did get Janna's flash off the backside as well. So Dumbledore doesn't have that cooldown because of the fact that the Equalizer comes through from Helios. So not overall a horrible Equalizer, but definitely agree it could have been better placed. As once again, coming into the top lane, that's now a 40 CS advantage coming through for Theldrin. He's having a fantastic early game on this Hecarim, and that just means bad things throughout the entirety of the game. If he can shove this into the turret, that's nearly map over for Helior. He will become an ult bot.
And Nardius actually hitting the max range boomerang there. Zykro down to about 500 health here on the bottom side, and that is not normal here for this Graves lane. Down 20 CS to the Sivir. And Nardius, I have to say, I've been so impressed by these spell shields that have been coming through. The Sivir play is fantastic, and just this bottom lane coming through from our Turkish team is just looking brilliant.
Yeah, it certainly is. So they're able to get an early advantage for themselves as well. It is equal items, and of course you would always favor Graves in a gunfight at this point in the game. However, can't underestimate the burst damage that comes out of Sivir as well, as Theocles and Julio Stito. They sound like two titans about to clash heads.
Yeah, and the explosive cast going to avoid that situation completely, but that is a big ultimate on cooldown, of course, early on in the game. I mean, we talk about explosive cast as being relatively short as far as the cooldown is concerned, but at level 8, not going to quite have enough
points. They're going for an invade on the blue. They've actually even bought their top laner down.
Oh, Theocles are going to get ignited here as the Deathmark comes through. That charm was outstanding, as there it is, and Reggie does manage to pick up the kill there with the Deathmark, but he's going to fall down in response. Dark Passage going to be taken here by the Nunu as he just careens out of that one. Helior looking to try and trade for a turret, but the bottom lane one's going down here as well for our Turkish team.
More importantly, the mid one might go down if Theldrin just decides to turn around and shove that one in. He doesn't. Goes top lane instead. That's important for Helior. He was able to close the CS gap. If he just drops the Equalizer on the next wave, might even be able to close it even further. Will he decide to so he gets a free shop in? Probably not.
Yeah, we'll see. Flame Spitter is going to come through here. Theldrin not really taking too much from that. So the Spirit of Dread's there.
So the reason you can drop the Equalizer in a situation like that is that currently you're 30 CS down. You pick up the whole minion wave pretty much guaranteed because the minion wave walks over the entirety of it. You go back, pick up your boots too, something like that. You'll definitely have the gold for it. And it allows you to reset the lane and come back in a position of power and doesn't really give the Hecarim a chance to fight you at all. Unless he goes like super ridiculously aggressive, in which case you have your shield anyway to just kind of float away from him. So doesn't decide to go with it, but definitely was a valid option to come through as we have some counter jungling now started off by Julius Steeder.
Yeah, Helio actually coming down to give him a hand too as Reggie's going to come round. Does have the upgraded sweeper already as Julius Steeder is actually able to take down that blue buff. Shurikens haven't necessarily been on point here from Reggie. Theocles is going to clear out some vision here as well. Does know that his blue buff has been taken. His energy continuing to shove.
Yeah, so energy 2-0-0 having a great early game coming through here. Has nearly picked up the Zhonya's Hourglass. Has also opted in for the Fiendish Codex. Fiendish Codex. Bit of CDR, bit of mana regen coming through there.
No mana regen. Not anymore.
There you go. Dumbledore looking to get aggressive in the bottom lane.
And does have a cheeky Amp Tome there as well. So looking to go for a Frost Queen's Claim early on.
Yeah, really good carding item coming through there.
Oh, so unless it's a Magize.
Yeah, or it could be a Magize. Both really valid options coming through.
Yeah, and I guess if you really want more disengage, that Frost Queen's Claim definitely a good idea. As Theocles is going to take down another Rift Scuttler here. 2,000 gold is the lead here for Beşiktaş as Helio wants to take down this outer turret. Is going to be able to. Thaldrin has picked up the Sheen, decides to forego the Phage just for now.
Yeah, and that's the thing about Phage. You can sit on the components. They're very cost efficient. Sheen isn't great as components, so if you only have money for one of them, you generally do keep the Phage as a component. As Helio actually stops his back. He would have probably got back there. Decides instead to just walk away out of lane. Needs to be careful now because the wave's going to be shoved in. Dragon up in 57 seconds, so he needs a shot before that next dragon. We've already talked about how important of a win condition it is for KLG to be able to snowball that objective. If he can't get back and shot before it, probably can't fight.
Yeah, and energy continuing to put pressure here in the mid. Nice shurikens to come out from Reggie, who does have Blade of the Ruined King entirely completed now and has a CS advantage. That kill early on to Theocles definitely helping out this Zed, as he probably wants to be able to pick up that Brutalizer. Thaldrin is going to make his way back towards the top lane.
That's a lot of damage coming through from the max charge.
Yeah, that devastating charge really starting to do some work. Reggie was cheating towards that bottom side. Theocles looking to do something. The bottom lane outer turret is going to fall down. Beşiktaş bottom lane is going to head back to base. Dumbledore actually already there. Did decide to go with that Magi's Soul Stealer. See whether he manages to pick up any more kills with KLG. They have actually started off this dragon.
And wow, what a spike coming through for the top laner. He's grabbed boots too, but he also grabbed a needlessly large rod.
My goodness.
All of a sudden, the dragon fight looking firmly in KLG's favor.
Yeah, and they managed to take that one down without a contest here. It was an orb of deception coming through, but Consume Smite still pretty strong here from Julius Steeder.
And this is what Nunu Rumble does to any team. The first three dragons are a complete shutout generally if you have both of those champions in your comp. One of them might give you the first couple, but wow, when you pair them together, just so much zone control, so much securing of objectives, you don't really want to fight. And they've also prolonged the laning phase just a little bit. So we've seen two turrets fall down. It's only 18 minutes into the game. By this time, we've normally seen much more. So this is kind of getting their... We said they needed an early lead. Unfortunately, they haven't been able to do that. Props to Beşiktaş to taking that one away, especially with such a scaling comp coming through in the top lane with a 31 CS advantage.
Yeah.
However, they have picked up the first two dragons, so they're still on track for around that 36-minute mark, being able to pick up the fifth and close out the game.
Yeah, we'll see whether they can actually do that. But of course, Beşiktaş, what is their sort of win condition? What do they need to be doing to try and win this game? And does it involve solo killing the top laner?
Yeah, so solo killing top, that's always a good one. So Thaldrin, big
that
tick
helps.
There.
Yep.
It's nearly picked up. He would have picked up probably his Trinity Force as well off that solo kill. Might even be able to get a lot of meaningful damage down onto this top lane turret as he pushes in here. He'll be able to take that one out. So that's huge news coming through for Beşiktaş. And their win condition is legitimately don't get the game to fifth dragons at 36 minutes and we win the game just by scaling.
So try and deny some dragons here as well.
Yeah, pick up some dragons. Grab some... If you want to go into the pick comp part of their composition, they set up some vision around key objectives and look to, I guess, force around there. As we see the solo kill coming through from Thaldrin, he just, all in, and Helio couldn't do anything.
Yeah, and that's why taking Ignite there into that lane definitely works out beautifully here for a Hecarim.
Yeah, so pretty much With an Ahri, with a Sivir, what you're looking to do is deny vision around like Baron or around objectives where you have the control. Wait for them to come to you. Use the Sivir ultimate and Ahri to be able to chain to get some CC out there. And then just all engage with your Hecarim and with your Gragas flying in from the shadows. Delete someone off the map because you really can't siege with these guys. Unless you use the Gragas. Wow, Bear, you're in trouble now.
He most certainly is. Hallingale's going to come across the top. Reggie's looking for something here as Energy's taking some auto attacks. The Exhaustor come through, but it's going to wear off as he's trying to get the damage down. Energy's going to fall. He does manage to trade here for Reggie, though, as Helio gets played back, but he's pretty big as he flashes forward. They pick up the kill into Dumbledore, loses some of those stacks as well as Thaldrin. He's trying to come in on this fight as Theocles is able to get Agilicino. Look at the ultimate as Nardius manages to pick up the kill into Thresh, but a double for Zykron. We know what he does with kills.
And what a hook coming through from Bear onto Thaldrin. Picked a Hecarim out of mid-air, able to keep him CC'd for long enough to his team to burn him down. Literally, that was from Heliorn. You mentioned it, Zykro, he's the big beneficiary off that missed time engage coming through from Beşiktaş. Now 3-0-0, has the Infinity Edge finished up, going to go back and pick up even more items, and that was huge.
Yeah, let's have a look at it again as Energy. Look at Reggie not actually using his abilities until after the exhaust.
Yeah, so he was able to get through. They pick up the first kill with the death mark. That was all really on Bear, you know, just zoning with every one of his abilities. I don't think he hit anything but an auto attack. But it was just all a mind game, Atlas. And in the end, they're able to get onto Theocles. And that's the hook that I'm talking about. He hits him when he counts. You miss 100% of shots that you don't take.
That's
but
exactly
that one
right.
He certainly nailed.
And that was the only one that they really needed to make sure that Thaldrin unable to sort of run over that fight.
Yeah, exactly right. So in the end, they're able to get it going. Wow, off the back of that. Zykro has finished up Static Shiv as well. So now he is an absolute powerhouse in this mid game, going to be able to do some ridiculous burst damage.
Yeah, and that's actually really good news here because he is down by 25 CS. Of course, Nardus also with sort of similar cost items with the Berserker's Greaves completed.
Yeah, exactly the same cost items coming through.
Exactly, is it?
Not 100%.
No, but basically?
Really close.
Yeah, it's about 30 off, I think.
Yeah.
If my memory serves.
You're really good with those.
Yeah. Look, we're okay. 300 gold is the lead, though, for the Sivir, sitting on a little bit more. So actually probably very, very similar as we look through it. Wants to hold on to the Avarice Blade for a little bit longer, a little bit greener.
Yeah, exactly right.
Love it.
The banker Sivir.
It's perfect.
Through.
It's perfect. It's like Frost Queen's claim,
if
Avarice
only it was
Blade
old
Ash.
Sivir. You remember old Sivir?
Oh, I do remember old Sivir, building Warmogs and stacking up that Bloodthirster. Beautiful stuff. Ricochet was a very fun ability back in the day. Let's not get nostalgic, though, about Sivir. I don't think that's necessary. It's a little bit sad.
As we see, actually, Energy looking to go for a pick here on Reggie. You have to be very brave. As I said, you miss that charm, he can all in you. Doesn't choose to go for it. But Reggie in a huge position of power. He's picked up a Last Whisper for himself as well as a Brutalizer, so very cost-efficient.
That's his core, like
Armor
already
pen
done.
Coming through here. We'll have to see exactly what he goes for. They might even dive.
Yeah, Zykro actually is going to quick draw over this wall. Julius Tito is going to get discovered and Award going to spot everyone out too. But 25 seconds on the dragon, you have to think KLG, that's all they're thinking about.
Yeah, exactly right. As long as they don't give away top turret, they're happy to trade nearly anything on the map right now. For that dragon as well. Bear just missing out on a hook.
Yeah, Dumbledore is coming around here as well. Griff's got available, but they haven't swept out this ward right in front of the pit. Reggie off on his own here on the bottom side.
Yeah, he's looking to get in behind. Maybe see if he can be the one flanking. Although Hecarim, he's back in base right now looking for the home guard gank to come through. We'll have to see who can take this little bit of a scuffle. Because Beşiktaş, they move in very aggressive, but still no teleport coming through.
Yeah, they're
you need to sweep that ward if you KLG before you fight.
Yeah, well, there's a couple of wards around here as well. And we know that Reggie does have that upgraded sweeper almost back up.
They've started up the dragon. This is horrible news. If they're able to take this one away.
Oh, that's going to go down so fast.
Yeah. So that's a huge win across the Turkish lineup. Theocles secures that one for his team. And all of a sudden, what should have been probably a 3-dragon lead in a pretty even game, door starting to close a little bit on what the KLG lineup brings.
Yeah, we'll see whether KLG can turn around, because of course they still do have a fantastic team fight if they get everything working exactly right, and there is a way that they can run over this game, especially considering the fact that these are their comfort picks. So really is important for a lot of these teams.
Yeah, it certainly is. So look, it's not that, like, oh, Dragon dead, game over, wrap it up, boys, surrender at 20. It's not dire straits, but it's one of the things that's what they were putting a lot of emphasis on. You could tell from their vision control that they wanted to secure Dragon. Even the map movement down there to try and get a pick on Energy was around getting the next Dragon, and they weren't able to secure that one. Fantastic vision control coming through. They understood that Hecarim, with the gank potential from the teleport, was just way too much. Probably would have deleted Zykro. So they didn't go with it in the end. Probably a wise decision, but it still hurts their overall game plan as Soldrin. He's looking to get aggressive. Bear throws another warning shot out.
Zoning hook. Zoning hook to come through there, of course. Helior
was going for the mad life. Didn't have flash. Never works.
Unfortunate. He actually... Oh, was it only just off cooldown?
No, as in when someone flashes into your hook.
Oh, right. Yes. Not sure why.
Would it ever flash that? Yeah, neither am I.
Oh, a little bit unfortunate. Pickaxe completed now for Zykro, though, going for that last whisper just for that three-item spike. Of course, Nardus has picked up his two items. Static Shiv and the Infinity Edge. I personally really like the Phantom Dancer on Sivir.
Phantom Dancer is a really good late game item, but it's one of those things, if you have the gold when you go back, you're always going to pick up a Static Shiv. Not to mention he committed so early into the Avarice Blade, and he wasn't really going to build much else out of it. As we see, Theophilus is now looking for a gank potentially in the mid lane. Not decides to disengage. Thaldrin's in the area. They've gone to a 1-3-1 split push, and this game's actually hit a lull where I didn't expect it to. Chaos Latin Gamer needs to be careful here that they don't just let this game slip away.
Yeah, Theocles is actually going to just throw an explosive cast.
Oh, he gets hooked.
Descends to come through here. They're going to start the engage. Box comes down, but Energy's here looking for something. Julius Tito does a fair bit of damage with the ult, but not enough. Reggie there a little bit late. Spirit Rush to come through. Orb of Deception only hits on the way forward.
And Helior got zoned away from that by Thaldrin. You feel if in that choke there was a Rumble ultimate.
Yeah.
Heck of a lot different team fight. Instead, it's not. It's just Nunu going in by himself. Julio Stito getting absolutely destroyed. Has only picked up raw HP stats. Not really much magic resist coming through there at all. And Energy made real short work of that Nunu.
Oh, yeah. And I mean, I guess the Absolute Zero was doing some work. Did a fair bit of damage for like half a channel. But if that's signs of things to come, KLG... it's not looking great.
Yeah, and all of a sudden, they're 3,000 gold behind. They don't have control over any part of the map. The picks will start coming through now from Ahri. She's moved into a second needlessly large rod item. You assume that's going to be the death cap. Just synergizes so well with the rest of the kit. Although, could, of course, be a Ludens. Anything is possible in this day and age, Atlas. Kids nowadays, but... Once again, they're going into the matching of the split push. I really think that they can play around Vision a little bit better on the top side of the map. Thaldrin just is so much stronger than Helior right now, especially in a 1v1. The dive has even opened up. And you
and
can see,
got a vision
they're just
monopoly.
Denying Vision right here, and he starts it up again.
Yeah, Thaldrin... oh, dodges out of the way of both of those harpoons. Helior able to at least right-click him with the Flame Spitter active to get a bit of damage down, but this horse really starting to ignore the damage coming through from the Rumble.
And he's just so far ahead for this part in the game. Thaldrin is an absolute monster. He's picked up the Trinity Force, picked up the components for both defensive items. Hecarim's the only real person that you want to go components-based. And now they are setting up around the Baron. I much prefer this call because they can deny Vision. They use the Sivir ultimate beautifully. And let's see what they can get done.
Yeah, and their split pusher doesn't have teleport here as well as... oh my goodness, Barry, you're in a whole host of trouble. Nardus is going to pick up that kill. Boomerang really starting to do some work with an added BF sword on top of everything else. Going for the Bloodthirster.
And Theocles' ult is still available. He can throw it right now, just zone him off the turret. Doesn't even have to. They just use a Hecarim. And all of a sudden, they're picking up objectives everywhere. KLG has missed a trick in this game. You felt like they could have done more. In the end, they even rotate Reggie up, and he's not able to impact at all. Might have been better just kept on pushing.
Yeah, and Thaldrin actually, I think, zoned them with his presence alone.
Yeah, he certainly did. He just took a gallop towards them all of a sudden. They wanted nothing to do with a Hecarim, who is 50 CS ahead and has a Frozen Heart now on that back, so is an absolute monster, so I don't really blame them, but really is a huge key to success in this game.
Yeah, and Soldrin, see whether he can actually carry this one forward. Of course, does have the teleport available. Theocles is just going to be in his own jungle at the moment. Heading back, he's going to grab a Raptor camp, so he's going to be able to clear out some vision. But there is no vision to clear. KLG are blind right
now. Yeah, KLG have absolutely no presence on this map. They don't have the vision. They're not able to, I guess, get the areas they need to make a team fight happen.
They've only just seen a member of Beşiktaş right now.
Yeah, really strange thing coming through here. Zykro has actually picked up another BF sword on top of his pickaxe.
Interesting.
When there's two frozen hearts, and Reggie, you're in a lot of trouble.
Yeah, Thaldrin looking to get something started. Deathmark to come down, but Reggie, not sure whether this is the funny business you're looking for. And Helior looks for the ult. Thaldrin actually taking a lot of damage, but the exhaust to come through. Nice Sonya's to come down as Dumbledore's trying to use that monsoon to do some work, but is going to be Thaldrin falling down. Nardis actually picking up Graves here on the backside as well. No, actually, Zykro is going to be able to escape. Oh my goodness, Energy misses the charm. And Julius Tito is able to flash to safety. Zykro so aggressive on this Graves.
Yeah, he certainly is. He nearly turned that. Wow, what a good catch.
Yep, the charm going to come through. Flash going to help that one out as Energy's able to pick up that kill. Inner turret going to be taken down immediately as well, as there's only one inner left available for KLG.
Only in Nunawap. He doesn't offer great wave clear. This is going to be the base broken Atlas, and only 31 minutes into the game, they'll pick up another dragon off the back, and all of a sudden, Beşiktaş in complete control.
Yeah, and this is going to even out the dragons here as well. When KLG, with all of this early pressure, it has completely gone now. This game in control of the Turkish team, and they are looking very, very strong. And it seems to me like they've definitely, I guess, got out the creases from their earlier experience.
Yeah, certainly have. Early game jitters gone. Thaldrin.
Oh, yeah.
Much more impressive in this game. Even their bottom lane really stood up to a bullying lane in Graves' Thresh. Were able to take it to them. It only has been since they started groping that Nardis has given up his 30 CS advantage or whatever he had in laning phase. So really big props to the entirety of the lineup. Able to get much better things done this time around. And now you see it's actually KLG that's trying to deny vision and set up some brush ganks, because honestly, that's all they can really do at this point.
Yeah, and they have set up a little bit more vision, and their vision around the Baron is
way
actually
too
a little
late.
Bit, yeah, it's a little bit more relevant though now, because they set up for that Baron vision a whole lot early, but it hasn't really amounted to anything, and it's almost like it was wasted gold.
Yeah, exactly right. They just weren't able to get it done. You look exactly where the wards were before that team fight. They were around the dragon area and then all throughout the blue bottom side of the jungle. So Beşiktaş using their vision much more than what we can say about KLG. And you see, they've already pincered them in here. Zykro, he's going to lose out on his blue red buff. And all of a sudden, you own nothing on the map if you're KLG. They don't have any options of where to fight, and they might even get picked here.
Actually, Julius Tito trying to set up for an absolute zero, but Bear's just going to explode. Julius Tito very low. Reggie in the back line trying to get something done, but he's going to die as Nardis takes that kill down. A double for Energy. The equalizer is going to get body slammed out of as Helios now going to have to try and escape. It is going to be the golden flamethrower, but the flash over here from Nardis, and this Sivir really starting to do some work. That Bloodthirster is terrifying, and Beşiktaş, they're going to be able to pick up the Baron after a clean ace, and I have a feeling they probably could have taken down an inhibitor for that, but instead it is going to be the guaranteed objective. Theocles able to tank that one up for days, and this Baron is not going to last long.
Yeah, it definitely isn't. And you know, I agree with the Baron call, because you have an open inhibitor. You just walk up, take that one whenever you want. And you also have the turret pressure, because their team isn't a great sieging team. They've got Sivir, they've got Ahri, both not great sieging champions coming through. So this gives them the tool to be able to take more than what a simple inhibitor would be able to. So I think props to Beşiktaş, good shot calling, and their denial of vision of this game has been spot on. They really approached it the right way, understood how they were going to win, and used this Ahri, who's now 6-1-5, to perfect effect.
Yeah, and KLG have just been unable to sweep enough as well. You can see they've got three upgraded Oracle's lenses. They are going to be able to sweep out some vision here, but it's way too late. And that's sort of the aim of the game here as far as the vision is concerned. It's the fact that Beşiktaş has had their vision where they need it, and KLG has had sort of spread out vision, but they haven't even been able to sweep effectively.
Yeah, they haven't just been able to get into position. They gave up control of the map. Remember when they gave away that first dragon, and we said that might be the window? just closing a little bit. It certainly turned into that way, because from that point, KLG hasn't looked proactive in their fighting, and they're not a very good comp as Nardius just spell shields the death sentence. And all of a sudden, two inhibitors down this game. They're looking to finish it up really early now.
And I like how you got ahead of it just a little bit. That inhibitor not quite falling down just yet, but you have to think it's going to be going down soon. Theocles is going to get death sentence. They're going to try and go in, but he's so tanky. Energy lands the Hail Mary charm, and Helior's going to die in the duration. Beautiful skill shot use there from Energy. Does miss that one, but the death sentence is going to go wide as well. Bears unable to find it. Just the tip of the orb of deception, and Beşiktaş, they're actually going for the victory here as Nexus turret's being focused down at the same time. Deathmark is going to land on Energy as he's going to go straight back to that shadow. There's those Zhonyas to come down as well, nullifying the damage. Spirit Rush to come through, and man, that Zed did not last long. Oh my gosh. Thaldron is huge on this horse, and Beşiktaş, 22-6, a 17,000 gold lead. And this is what we're expecting out of Turkey.
Yeah, a much more calm, cool, calm, and collected came coming through as well. You got to say they gave up a couple of the objectives, snowballed their lanes, won outright, and then in the end, through good vision denial, just took over the entirety of the map. Props to those guys for being able to peg it back. Yeah. Probably weren't expecting to lose their first game, but boy, did they strike back hard.
Yeah, they really did, and it seemed to have lit a fire under them as well. We'll see whether that comes through in their next showings, because I was especially impressed by Thaldron. He played a lane against a comfort pick Rumble, which would otherwise be hard. He had a massive lead early on in that CS department and ended up just running over the game and demanded so much respect.
Yeah, he certainly did. It really hurt the Graves pick most of all, because Zykro, he was the most fed on the lineup, but he wasn't able to do anything. There was a huge Hecarim every time he went anywhere near a teamfight, just ready to leap onto his head. Yep. And the solo kill even came through in the top lane. He just did lots of little impressive things that got that game going in the right direction for Beşiktaş.
Yeah, definitely looked great. But KLG, I mean, they are down 0-2 now. We'll see whether they can pick up a victory moving forward. But you have to admit, that was probably going to be one of their toughest opponents that they're going to meet so far. And of course, they have met up with the Chiefs as well earlier on. They're now 2-0, so they've had a rough start. And we'll see whether they can pull it back as this group stage moves forward.
Yeah, and you know, there's still promising signs there. They controlled the early part of the objectives very well once again. Their bottom lane looked like they were performing pretty well. Bennett was uncharacteristic in some of his skill shots that he missed. But there were other promising signs. Look, Reggie in the mid lane, he didn't have a great laning phase, but he was able to translate that to some pressure. Helior probably needs to step up a little bit, I think, if they're going to have much more success in this tournament. Julio Stito needs to, I think, be more proactive is the word that I'm going to use. Needs to look for deep vision, especially if he's going to play Nuno and try and bully the other jungler around. In the end, just wasn't tracking anything to do on that map. Lost control a little bit too early. And I think, yeah, there's promising signs there. There's definitely things that they can work on for day two and three. And they're not out by any count so far.
Yeah, well, that's true. And we'll see whether they can play on some extra confidence as well moving forward, because you have to think, Julio Stito, in my mind, was the one that was sort of not playing to the way that Anunu probably could in that early game. And you have to think that it had a lot to do with the fact that, you know, Turkey, home ground advantage, they must be intimidated by this team.
Yeah, they definitely would be intimidated by this team. Lots of people have actually pointed to Turkey for the team to beat. Yeah. And Theocles, like, don't take anything away from him. He was able to sneak behind, get a good early gank. So he was definitely taking it early into Julio Stito and just wasn't able to keep up.
Yeah, well, let's have a look at a replay, ladies and gentlemen, of exactly what won Beşiktaş that game.
Yeah, so this was a fight that they tried to start in the jungle. So they throw the box down, but look at the top of the map. Helior being completely zoned away. So as we roll this one out, you see Reggie, he tries to fly in and help out Julio Stito. But in the end, Rumble continuing to be zoned, can't get past the Ocalis, now can't get past the Hecarim. And that's what really turned it. You see how late the equalizer comes out? If that was any sooner, probably would have been a much easier team fight coming through from KLG. I'm not saying they would have won, but look how low some of the health bars are as this fight finishes up, as the turret's really nicely tanked by Hecarim off that back end. But that's just one of the examples of where they didn't seem to be on the same page. It was a little bit of a face check because of denial of vision, and that was really what sold me on the whole Beşiktaş team comp, was the fact that they were able to control vision so well. But I think that there were still some things that they could have done there in that game, KLG, to make it work.
Yeah, well, We'll see whether they use the same style moving forward. I want to talk about energy as well, because especially highlighted in that last replay, his consistent damage throughout that was so beautiful to see. And he may have missed a few, optimistic charms coming into this, but the ones that he hit were the ones that he needed to hit. And especially at the very end, their Helio, when they were trying to defend their base, he hit the charm that won them the game at that stage.
Yeah, but even before that, the flash charm into Zydra on the bottom lane really secured that team fight and let them push in for an inhibitor. So that guy the whole game was really hitting the charms that he needed to hit. So I definitely agree. Energy was a huge part of their success. As I said, you really need to not build a comp around Ahri, but play around Ahri and how you set up the vision, and they did it well.
Yeah, well, let's go to an interview.
I want to ask my first question. We were surprised by your first performance at the first game. What went wrong for you?
The ban pick phase was actually quite wrong for us. We didn't get the picks that we wanted. We screwed our early game, so the game kind of snowballed. So it was a mistake, but I don't think it's going to happen again.
At the first match, you picked a late game oriented composition, and it didn't went as you expected. Is that why you picked early mid-game composition for the next match?
Kinda. Like, at the first game, we shouldn't have picked Vlad because our whole comp was, like, so late, so we had to change it. Like, we couldn't. But at the second game, we did a better ban pick phase, so that's why we won.
So you will play against the Chiefs, and they won their first two games. Have you prepared any counter strategies against them?
Of course, but I'm not going to tell them right here. So, yeah, okay. That's it.
So thank you for the interview. Is there anything you want to say to your fans, to your supporters?
Can I say it in Turkish?
Of course you can.
Teşekkür ediyoruz herkese. İlk oyun biraz sıkıntılı geçti ama bir daha alacağını düşünmüyoruz.
He said that. Can you translate in English too?
You should.
I'm not going to do it.
Okay. he said that it won't happen again about the first match, and he's happy for the supporters. So thank you, Taldrin, for being here. And we're up to Caner, I guess.
Thaldrin, so incredibly confident saying that it'll never happen again. Well, we'll see whether that is actually true as they move into their next few games. Of course, it is still going to be pretty tough competition.
Yeah, it certainly isn't. They have to take on the Chiefs. So pretty much whoever wins this game, you would think nearly would be the favorites going in. After Ints, they were a little bit disappointing.
Yeah, they were just a little bit. Or was it just the fact that that LeBlanc got a little bit out of control? Not entirely sure. Plus, they haven't had a whole lot of time there. There might be a little bit of jet lag issue. Not entirely sure.
Yeah, it definitely is a possibility. But, you know, in the end of the day, need to get the wins on the board. They went up against a strong opponent, weren't able to get it done. So I'm really interested to see how Beşiktaş is able to do against the Oceanic team.
Yeah, well, we'll see how they do. That is a little bit further down the line. Ladies and gentlemen, after the break, we are going to have Southeast Asia taking on CIS. Guys, don't go anywhere.